Coming up next on Rainier Country, Pierce County is gearing up for the U.S. Open at Chambers Bay. We'll take a look at how Chambers Bay came to be. And while we're out at University Place, we'll visit the iconic Curran House and Apple Orchard. Fife is planning the centennial celebration of their city fountain. And what would you do if a Lahar was coming down the mountain? We look to Orting for some practical advice. These stories and more just ahead on Pierce County TV. Welcome to Rainier Country. In June 2015, Pierce County's Chambers Bay Golf Course will join the ranks of such prestigious courses as Pebble Beach, Bethpage, Marion, and Pinehurst, among others. At these courses, some of the greatest players ever to walk the links made U.S. Open history, and Chambers Bay is poised to become the next great field of champions. But unlike the other courses whose golf history goes back generations, Chambers Bay is a newcomer to the sport. Eric Ebel explains there's a lot more to Chambers Bay than just breathtaking views and unbeatable recreational opportunities.
It's a part of Pierce County that was destined for something greater. The property now known as Chambers Bay is the site of the 2015 U.S. Open, golf's premier competition. And it has a long and storied history that begins well before the arrival of the first European settlers.
Traditional story for the Silicum tribe is that was a very large mountain peak there, the highest place you could see from anywhere.
Danny Marshall is the chair of the Silicum Indian Tribal Council, an elected 9-member body charged with governing their people and preserving their heritage.
In the history of our tribe, we have a story about how we survived the great flood in the world by tying a canoe to the top of that peak.
For as long as anyone can remember, the Silicum tribe has been made up of 5 related bands of Native Americans: the Silicums, the Sastuck, the Spanaway, the Tlithlow, and the Sugwalachu. Around 600 people, who spoke a sub-dialect of the Puget Sound Salish language, made their homes and their living around Chambers Creek, or as they knew it, Silicum Creek.
There were two main things: gathering food for survival and also protecting yourself from raids from outside of the area. The tribes around in this area were very peaceful and interactive with each other because they knew that building relationships was the way to gain power.
And when the first European ships sailed through what would become Puget Sound in 1792, most resident tribes expected to build relationships with these newcomers as well. The Hudson's Bay Company soon established trading posts along the Sound, which led to the inevitable surge in the non-Indian population. Among those early settlers was a prominent judge and businessman named Thomas Chambers.
It was on this spot that Thomas Chambers built the first mills in Pierce County. It was the same spot that the Silicum Indians had existed for over 400 years.
This is a time when a lot of people were coming to Oregon, and a few were looking for different places to come and came up into this region, came into Centralia, came all the way up north here.
Arnie Handland has taught history to students at Curtis High School for the last 41 years. His ancestors, the Leland family, settled in University Place, just north of Silicum, in 1904, just 50 years after the first Americans began making land claims in the area.
And it was prime real estate, with sweeping views of the Puget Sound. Although Chambers Creek, Chambers Bay, and Chambers Elementary School are all named for him, Handelin says early Silicum settler Thomas Chambers never actually set foot in the area that now bears his name.
Instead, Chambers built his sawmill, grist mill, and flour mill on the southern bank of the creek, very near where today the Chambers Bay Marina now resides. It would be another 30 years before the mills got their first neighbor, the United States government, which hired the Pacific Bridge Company in the 1890s to mine gravel for use at Army forts all along Puget Sound.
And when those forts were completed, it was then sold to the gravel companies.
A host of gravel companies that evolved through mergers and acquisitions to eventually become Lone Star Sand and Gravel, which took over operations in 1959 and lasted more than 3 decades, spanning more than 100 years of digging for what was known worldwide as some of the purest gravel available.
Sand and gravel that came out of there, and it has to do with the ice age and how the melting of the ice brought this deposit into the area. It's known as Stilicum grade, and it's just highly, highly desirable. It's very clean, very pure, and didn't take a lot of processing.
It wasn't until the early 1990s that Lone Star's mining lease ran out, and Pierce County officials revealed they had something else in mind for the property. After 100 years of industrial use, Pierce County has reclaimed the spectacular Chambers Creek property for the public, featuring a 3-mile trail, 2 miles of beach access, a large meadow area, a beloved playground, and of course, Chambers Bay.
They had a master plan of what they wanted to do with it. One of those was to put in a golf course, and obviously they did that. Ended up being a pretty tremendous golf course.
One that will become the site of the U.S. Open in 2015, opening a new chapter in Pierce County history. At Chambers Bay Golf Course in beautiful University Place, Washington, I'm Eric Ebel for Rainier Country.
Our next story is also in University Place. It's about a unique residential property. In the 1950s, the Curran House represented the architectural cutting edge. Today, it's listed on the State Heritage Register and the National Register of Historic Places. Linda Sees picks up the narrative.
Straddling a hill on the west side of University Place, the Curran House was built in 1955, designed by award-winning Tacoma architect Robert Price.
This was the original great room design. The kitchen, the living, and the dining spaces flow together, which is very novel at the time. Now, everybody wants a great room, and that's the way we all live.
Robert Price is noted for his modern, post-World War II designs, using innovative and affordable building materials like the newly invented plywood.
This is a telephone pass-through, so that you have one telephone and it could be shared between this master bedroom and the bedroom next door.
Price's designs incorporate native wood and a lot of glass, like these ceiling-to-floor windows in the living room and family room. The home was built for Charles and Mary Louise Curran, one of the founding families of University Place. When the Currans purchased the land, there were only 300 residents. Now there are over 30,000. Charles used the 7-acre property as a hobby farm.
They had chickens, they had beef cattle, they had all kinds of vegetables and fruit. They had 2 horses that everybody who lived here in the 70s will remember.
And although growing apples is supposed to be impossible on this side of the Cascades, the farm boasts 200 apple trees representing 15 different varieties. When age forced the Currans to leave their homestead, Charles wanted the property to serve University Place. The apple orchard is now a beloved city park where residents can adopt an apple tree, attend summertime concerts, and participate in the popular cider squeeze every fall.
The house is symbolic of the huge growth in University Place in the middle of the last century.
Over the past several years, the house suffered from age and vandals. On the day of our visit, volunteers from the Kiwanis Club were on the job patching and painting walls and making minor repairs, helping to restore this iconic home.
It does have about 60 years worth of history here, and we felt it was important to preserve it. So we've got a number of our members that are helping out on it.
The University Place Historical Society has been given a 5-year lease to the home and charged with restoring the structure and formulating plans for its future use. Those plans include a museum of University Place history.
It'll give something for the children in the area in the future to see what a house back in the mid-50s was like.
Almost every town has one, a structure, a monument, or something that captures the people's imagination and seems to say, this is our community. In Fife, that special monument is a fountain, and it's about to get a makeover as it celebrates 100 years. Laurel McQuaid has our story.
Nearly 50 years before Fife was a city of record, in 1914, Henry Saccade erected a fountain in the intersection of Milton Way and Westside Dairy. Those streets are now the busy 54th Avenue and 20th Street.
Originally, this was Gardenville, and then they changed the name to Fife after the man's name was Fife. I'm not sure exactly the year that they changed it to Fife. It didn't become a city until the 50s.
Supported by the businesses on each corner, horses would drink from the fountain and rest while their owners purchased goods at the stores.
It started out as a horse trough and now is a monument in our parking lot, and it's really an icon here in our city, and we're looking forward to giving it some recognition for its centennial anniversary.
Businesses moved north and east to take advantage of the new Seattle-Tacoma Highway. Fife was incorporated in 1957, just in time for the new interstate freeway, and the fountain was moved to a vacant lot next to the fire station.
The face of Fife has changed tremendously from its agricultural roots to much more business and commerce focused at this point.
In 1986, the fountain was moved to its current location near the Fife Swim Center, and Fountain Memorial Park was created on the corner.
This park was pretty much community made. And a matter of fact, I live in Fife, and one of the trees here, the lady I bought my house from, she decided to donate it to this park. And so my tree is sitting in this park.
The fountain is showing its age at almost 100, but a fall centennial celebration will begin a restoration project and one more move closer to its intersection beginning.
We're going to be putting it in on the corner of 20th and 54th and setting it back into the park. So that you'll see that right as you come into the city off of I-5 or come across the freeway and make that corner there. We want that to be our gateway monument to really let people know that you've arrived and you're in Fife. We're also looking to restore the function of a fountain, both from the water feature aspect and lighting. So it's quite an undertaking.
I think it's going to be a great, great thing for the city of Fife. Just a symbol that all of us can remember and just hope that it lives on.
Perhaps the newer population doesn't have that historical connection and understand the significance, but there is a great deal of interest on the part of longtime Fife residents to really commemorate and honor the fountain as something that has been in this city for 100 years, and there's not many things around there left like that, so they're very interested in making this a very special occasion.
To learn more about the Fife Fountain and the centennial celebration, visit the Fife website at cityoffife.org.
Getting around Puyallup just got a little bit easier, for the next year at least. In June, Pierce Transit launched the new Puyallup Connector Route 425.
Yay! Very good.
And with that, the new route officially opened. Two 25-foot vehicles, colorfully decorated with Puyallup highlights, will scoot passengers to important locations from South Hill to downtown Puyallup.
This is to increase the mobility for seniors and others who don't have viable transportation from down here in the city, Maine, to be able to reach up to South Hill, and for people on South Hill to be able to reach down into the city.
In fact, the buses will actually enter the parking lots of several locations, making it easier for passengers with mobility issues to reach their destinations. This connector route is the fourth in a series of demonstration projects, like the Gig Harbor Trolley, that Pierce Transit has launched in the wake of the 2010 and 2011 budget cuts.
It's a one-year project that the Board of Commissioners for Pierce Transit approved to see if we could get enough ridership to make this a go of this. If we have great ridership, we'll operationalize it and continue on as a permanent service.
The circular route of the two vehicles puts a bus by each stop every 30 minutes. Popular stops include the South Hill Mall, YMCA, Good Samaritan Hospital, City Hall, Pioneer Park and the Library, and the Sounder Station. Route 425 will also open up Puyallup and South Hill to riders of other established routes.
We have the Fife-Edgewood-Milton connector that comes into our downtown transit center. So those people now can connect to our Puyallup connector and then have access for medical appointments, shopping ideas.
This is a new service. It was designed by the community investment team, made up of a lot of the community members like MultiCare, the city, SHAG, and then some citizens who were also on the community investment team.
Members of the community investment team worked hard to bring this new connector to life. But like many good ideas, Route 425 had a humble beginning with Councilman Vermillion and Fife Mayor Glenn Hall.
The two of us having a beer at Crockett's actually turned into a couple beers as we were sitting there drawing maps, trying to figure out how we could make this all come together as one cohesive entity and connect all the communities within our east area.
Connector fares are $2 for adults and 75 cents for youth under 18 and discount card holders. Will the project be a success? It might just be a safe bet if senior ticket sales are an indication.
They, in fact, had to come a second day because they sold out of passes the first day.
and there's been an overwhelming desire to have this kind of transportation. So I think it will be a great success.
During the busy summer months, buses run daily from 10 a.m. to 6 p.m. On Thursday, they run until 9 p.m. for those attending concerts in Pioneer Park. And the buses will start at 9 a.m. on Saturday for people attending Puyallup's Farmers Market.
This is a great opportunity for people here in the town to use transit, keep your car at home, save gas, save emissions, and sit back and let somebody do the driving.
For more information about the route schedules and fares of the Puyallup Connector, visit the Pierce Transit website at piercetransit.org/Puyallup. Word is spreading. People in Sumner have a new way to see and experience their small city. By foot or by bike, Greg McClellan shows us a trail system that's tucked away in the Sumner Warehouse District.
Ken Woolery already knows about Sumner's best kept secret. He's out here three times a week, young at heart, making sure exercise is his top priority.
I'm recovering from open heart surgery in February, and this is part of my recovery, is get out and walk.
It gives us exercise. It just, we commune with the outdoors. It doesn't get much better than this.
The Sumner Link Trail is no walk in the park. It's a 5.5 mile paved stretch of trail that's attracting seniors, families, and even commuters.
The trail actually offers a great option to get off 167 and maybe incorporate your exercise into your commute.
The Sumner Link Trail starts near the Sumner Industrial Park on Stewart Road east of Highway 167 below Lakeland Hills. It weaves behind the businesses ending at Traffic Avenue by Highway 410.
It's relatively flat. There's a couple bridges that they have to go up over the river. Most people don't know it's out here. There's not a real good trailhead for parking, but it's 3 miles complete. I mean, you can follow the trail, and people are discovering it, I think, as the weeks go on.
Surrounded by nature's beauty, you'll hardly notice you're in the middle of a warehouse district. There is a popular salmon spawning site from the White River to Salmon Creek, and meadows of flowers. Benches, picnic tables, and barbecue sites offer fun little rest stops along the way, with plenty of attractions you won't see from the road.
You go along the railroad tracks a little bit, you go along the White River, you can actually see the spot where the Salmon Creek runs into the White River, and when the salmon are spawning, you can watch them making their way up the White and into the Salmon Creek. So lots of variety, lots of different parts of Sumner in the valley that we don't normally get to see.
Parking can be a little tricky. The best places to pick up the trail are the 24th Street Trailhead off 167. Or from Traffic Avenue, drive into town and turn left on State Street. Ken Woolery has seen a lot of trails during his 20 years on the Foothills Rails to Trails Coalition Board, and his hometown trail doesn't disappoint.
I love the trail. My dogs do too. I love seeing people out using it. I think it's a miracle that Sumner got this whole thing connected so fast.
Sumner's Link has won awards from the Forever Green Council and the Foothill Rails to Trails Coalition. Money from grants, the state, and Rails to Trails help the city of Sumner finish the 5.5-mile stretch one piece at a time. The three newest sections are near Stewart Road and Salmon Creek.
After just piecing away at it and working, frankly, very, very hard on it for the last few years, it's really done. There's a couple little pieces to be finished yet, but for the most part, it's a finished trail, and we're really proud of it.
As you enjoy the trail, Sumner will continue to add places of surprise and delight. Signs are coming to help guide you to the next feature and point you to other amenities in town. Also in the works are pocket parks and more places to pull off the trail. Before heading out, you can print a trail map from the city's website. Greg McClellan for Rainier Country.
The Oso mudslide gave us a glimpse of the devastation left in the wake of moving earth. Imagine that flow intensified by the altitude of Mount Rainier and the tons of water released by melting ice and snow. That majestic snow-capped beauty overlooking our homes is a slumbering, active volcano.
I like to say that the mountain that your grandparents saw is a little bit different from what you see and what your grandchildren will see.
Over the years, water mixed with sulfuric gases has chemically altered large deposits of rock, making them weak and more easily dislodged. What makes Mount Rainier so dangerous is that much of this weakened rock is on the west face of the mountain, directly above the communities of the Puyallup Valley.
Orting may be the most volcanic vulnerable city in the United States. We can be the most prepared city in the United States, too.
Chief Gibson joined a group of 10 local and state officials who visited Nevada del Ruiz, a 17,000-foot volcano in Colombia, almost a mirror image of Mount Rainier. In 1985, a community near Armero was all but destroyed by a Lahar. More than 20,000 people were killed.
The composition of a Lahar is like cement, and if you've seen a debris flow over at Mount Rainier, and perhaps many viewers have been up there in summers and they've seen this, what looks like quicksand that has gelled and solidified, it's difficult to kick a boot into this material.
The sediments and debris of Lahars and mudflows remain in play for decades and centuries as deposits change the landscape and rivers form new channels.
It's going to be a long time before the valley is habitable again. And I think that's something that all of us need to keep in mind for our planning purposes.
Orting and the other communities and farms that dot the valley sit on the soil deposited by the electron mud flow, which science and native folklore place around 1500 AD. The electron sediment and deposits change the shape and reach of the Puget Sound inlets.
Anyone who's experienced Lahars on the Toutle River in 1980 will tell you that this is something that we want to prepare for.
And that was the purpose of the information and training exchange with Colombia. Following the Armero disaster, Colombian officials and first responders made volcano awareness and safety their highest priority.
In 2008, the Colombians successfully evacuated 12,000 people before a Lahar came through, and very few people were killed, and they were folks up on the mountain.
Orting Fire and Rescue, the City of Orting, Pierce County Emergency Management, the U.S. Geological Survey, and other partners are preparing tools and procedures to help citizens prepare for volcanic activity and the possibility of evacuation. That training could be very personal.
Door to door. That's what the Colombians do.
One goal of Orting Fire and Rescue is to conduct a total community evacuation drill, just like the Colombians did.
The people of Florida and the southeastern part of the United States know what to do during a hurricane. They know where to get the information. They know what to do every year when a hurricane comes through. People who live in earthquake country know what to do. They know how to prepare for it and what to do during an earthquake. The same thing with tornadoes. So every area has its hazard. Here we also have a hazard from Lahars. And so it's just one thing that we need to be prepared for. It's part of the price that we pay for living in this beautiful part of the country.
A Lahar may not happen in our lifetimes, may not happen in our children's lifetimes or our grandchildren's lifetimes. But we owe it to our community to develop a culture of being prepared.
There's no reason for people to have a sense of panic, but only of preparation, and to have a culture of safety in their community so they can go on living here in this beautiful, beautiful valley in greater safety and in comfort.
Learn more about Mount Rainier, Lahars, and emergency preparedness on the Orting and Pierce County websites, the USGS website, and sign up for Pierce County text or email emergency alerts. Integrity is a core military value. It's also the name of a new gate, or Access Control Point, ACP. Integrity Gate has been 3 years in the planning, over 1 year into construction, and the first vehicle is expected to roll through by the end of 2014. Joint Base Lewis-McChord consists of three neighborhoods, Fort Lewis, Maine, Fort Lewis North, and McChord Field. Integrity Gate will be the third entry point to Lewis North, the portion of the base which lies to the west of Interstate 5.
We have grown over the last 10 or 12 years. We've more than doubled in population for Joint Base Lewis-McChord in total, and most of that population growth was here on Lewis North.
40% of the entire base population now reports to Lewis North.
This used to be kind of a sleepy, hollow portion of the base, but it was also very buildable land. And so it was an obvious place to expand for the number of troop units that got stationed here over the last 10 to 12 years.
Integrity Gate is approximately 1 mile north of DuPont and connects to the DuPont Steilacoom Road, allowing for some of the traffic to flow north and west without impacting the I-5 corridor.
To get off of the corridor that goes through Joint Base Lewis-McChord, where it's only three lanes on both sides, to get them to get off of I-5, choose to get off at the southernmost part as they're going north, and the northernmost part as they're coming into the corridor from the north.
And not just getting onto the base, but off the base property as well.
Between 4 and 6 p.m., folks go home. So those that live off the base, we find that the two gates that serve JBLM North now get very congested, and there's sometimes quite long delays, 15 to 20 minutes, just to get out those gates.
Lewis North is the location for unit headquarters, barracks, warehousing, and motor pool activities. A recent traffic study indicated that Integrity Gate could expect 1,500 cars per hour. It is designed to handle 2,000. The idea behind the new gate is to spread the traffic out among three entry points and ultimately relieve some of the congestion on the interstate and surrounding communities. And that wraps up this edition of Rainier Country. You can watch these stories again or share them with friends on our YouTube channel, online at piercecountytv.org, or download our new mobile app. I'm Dave Hinman. Thanks for watching.